Hi there, it's Mandy, and this is my turn to do Deck of the Week. So I've chosen a deck that I bought, it's got to be about 4 years ago now, you know, it's quite a few years ago. I've only ever done a couple of readings with this deck. That's not because there's anything wrong with the deck, it's because I always use my Rider-Waite deck, because I'm so used to it. But this is based on the Rider-Waite system. And you can see that in some of the cards, but in others it's like, whoa. Okay, now before I tell you what the deck is and before I show you anything, I do want to say that I bought this as a secondhand rare deck. It was out of print at the time and it didn't come with an instruction book, and I don't like reading the book anyway because I like to read intuitively. I like to see what I get from the images. But I've got to say, some of these images, I would love to know why those particular choices were made. It's quite a striking deck. It is called the Lunatic Tarot. And I believe that the artist is Chinese. It kind of like feels it's a bit kind of manga anime type style to it, some of it. The guy's name, I assume it is a guy, is called Evan Yifeng, and the deck was originally brought out, as far as I know, in 2005. Okay, other than that, all I can tell you is my perception of this deck. The artwork is amazing. So here we are, this is the box that it came in. I mean, seriously, look at that. It's absolutely profound. I have not come to a conclusion yet what that image on the box is quite representing. So let's take it from there. The one thing I would like to say about this deck is it definitely has a kind of like a theme and a style, which is very much in the colours, but there are, he seems to have gone, I don't know, there seems to be about three or four different kind of styles within it. You'll see what I mean as I go along. So starting with the Fool. Okay, there he is. I hope you can see that properly. I'm sorry, there he is, there she is. So the Fool is most definitely a female as far as I'm concerned. Yeah, I mean, it's got the jester's kind of like hat on the head. It's got the kind of like the dog is a bit more like a sort of wolf type dog. It's very sort of Cirque du Soleil with that ball. I mean, it definitely looks like some sort of performer. I don't know whether I can see any of the kind of, I don't know how much of a connection with that I can see with the original Fool card, which is absolutely fine because, as has been said in these videos before, you need to be inspired by the actual image that is right there in front of you. Yeah, I mean, that jester's hat, I kind of think stands out, as does kind of that the sexy costume. It's quite a combination. So it's playful, but at the same time, I don't know that the character necessarily looks happy. It's kind of, it's almost kind of like there's something a little bit sad about it for me. I don't know kind of, yeah, I mean, always open to interpretation in readings, but that is the Fool card. Okay, so moving on to the Magician. I mean, I could probably talk for hours about each card. Now, I can't do that or this is gonna last forever. So the Magician, I love. Very sort of Mad Hatter type hat, but look how cool he is. I mean, he's just kind of, he's gorgeous. He is absolutely gorgeous. And I just do think he does look like, you know, that he's going to fool you. I kind of like feel he is a magician and, you know, prepare to be stunned by his illusions and prepare to be fooled by his tricks. I really like it. I love the choice of the hat. It really stands out for me. Okay, so moving on to the High Priestess. Seriously, look at her. I mean, she does have a lot of the qualities of the original Rider-Waite. I mean, she's got the moon there. The moon is huge. I kind of like feel the moon really sort of like somewhat dominates the card here. Interestingly, this archway comes up in another card, which I will show when we get to it. So rather than the two pillars, it is a complete arch. And as I said, there's a little bit of a theme going on here. She's very, very covered up. So I definitely feel there is a lot going on under those robes. She's gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous. But she has the scroll, she has the moon, and she has all the hidden stuff. So I can really kind of see the connection there with the Rider-Waite image. Okay. Brace yourselves for this Empress. She is so sexy. Seriously, look at her. I mean, she's absolutely kind of, oh, I've got to get the lighting right on it. She's absolutely kind of living in the lap of luxury. She's very, very kind of like sexual. It kind of looks to me as though that chair is kind of floating in the air. Yeah, I would say other than the comfort part of it, I kind of like do feel that he's gone his own way with this Empress, but I just feel, I don't know, I just feel that she's maybe the bit of the kind of like the yummy mummy, the sort of the cougar thing. I can just imagine kind of, I don't know, she's, to me, she's sexy in a quite a mature sort of way. I love her. I think she's fantastic. Alternatively, the Emperor, look at him. So here we have a proper mature character. I mean, he's been given the grey hair. He's got kind of like the white fur around him. He kind of does look as though he's got life experience. He's very, very serious. I mean, yeah, he's got the Aries kind of like, you know, on his throne, the same as in the Rider-Waite. I just love all these oranges and browns. Yeah, he just is a very kind of serious, sensible, wise older man. That is what I get from that. The Emperor. Moving on. So here it is again, that archway on the Hierophant. So yeah, I mean, there just is, he's connected the Hierophant with the High Priestess, which I kind of like think is quite interesting. So yeah, it is exactly the same archway. Got the right one there. Yeah, the Hierophant. So again, you know, beautiful robes. There's a lot of detail on there. And the difference with this archway and the High Priestess is there are those two little sort of like monks, like looking up to him, at his feet. So yeah. I mean, that to me is full of kind of like lavish richness, you know, the material of his costume. It's very, very, he's very extravagantly dressed. But then so is the High Priestess. So that's quite an interesting choice on that one. Okay. Get this for the lovers. Oh my God, I just love this lovers card. It's just gorgeous. Look at them. Look at them. I mean, they are just the perfect in love couple. I just think that is absolutely fabulous. And yeah, and it's kind of like they're covered by that bed of, I don't know if it's roses or could be roses, flowers. It's just that love is blossoming. It's just such a gorgeous image of the lovers. Some of these pictures, to me, I would love to have a blown up sort of poster and have it framed and up on the wall in my house. I think the artwork is gorgeous, particularly like that one. Okay, so moving on now, we have the Chariot. I mean, look at him. I mean, never mind the sphinxes. He's basically just got two, I don't know, servants, or I don't like to use the word slaves, but there is a sort of bondagey type of feel to this. But yeah, I mean, you can see who the master is, but I mean, he is like an absolute rock star. I mean, Evan what's his name? Evan C. Feng, Evan Yi Feng. He definitely knows how to illustrate sexy looking people. There is no question about that. That's the Chariot. Most of the characters are quite serious. Here we have, oh, this is gorgeous, Strength. So the Lion is this kind of like this guy. She is sort of, you know, she is absolutely kind of like taming this guy. I mean, look at the hair. I mean, it's, I just find this so kind of, yeah, awesome. I mean, she has definitely got a gentleness and an innocence about her, and he's quite, I don't know, there's something more natural about her, whereas his image is more, you know, I don't think you're born with hair like his. He's had his hair done to be like that. But you know, I kind of like feel she is definitely the one who is kind of controlling this situation. Now, the Hermit. This is amazing, this choice. I had to really look hard to see the person in this particular image, because it's all about the light and the arm. Look at the arm. I mean, there is so much emphasis on the arm and the light, and kind of like the actual person himself is really, really kind of like almost not in the picture, but you're being very, very kind of lured into it. So although, yes, he is a hermit, he's very much kind of a guiding light. So he's not really hiding himself away at all. I think that, that sleeve and that arm, I kind of feel if that came up for me in readings, that would, I don't know, it looks like a wing. I don't know. It also looks like it's a direction to me that is sort of pointing. Whatever, I don't know how, which way it's going to come up on the video. If it was reversed, it would be the other way. I just honestly do feel that this is kind of luring you into to his knowledge, his wisdom, and what he knows. And funnily enough, on this video, looking at it now, I'm looking at it on the screen, I'm really noticing the cross, which to me, I kind of missed that. Once I realised I was looking at an arm, I was so drawn to the light and the arm. Yeah, it was quite hard to find the person, but now the cross is becoming quite apparent. Okay, so now, this is one of the ones that I would like to speak to Evan about, because I don't get this card. I'm not going to lie, I don't get how this card is the Wheel of Fortune. So if anybody has got any kind of ideas why it is the Wheel of Fortune, I mean, it's a nice card, and the card itself would say something. That is the Wheel of Fortune. I suppose there's something of a cog going on in the background, but the character in it, which I think is male, part of the wheel, is he in a wheel? I mean, I would not know that that was a wheel unless I, you know, apart from the fact that it says on the card, it's got the, at the top of the card, it says the name of it. So I just, that's the only reason I would know that that is the Wheel of Fortune. So, and in the couple of readings I've done with this deck, this card has not come up in the reading. So, yeah, I mean, it's definitely someone thinking something. Very unusual choice. I'd really love to know how the artist kind of came to make those decisions on this one. Makes it all the more intriguing. So, look at this for justice. How cool is she? She's in black and white, and I kind of like feel that's a very deliberate choice. It's kind of like, well, this situation is very black and white. I mean, she's got the scales there, she's got the sword there. She's very, very tall. Character. She's very I like her, the fact that she's leaning back. It's like she can look at the situation objectively and see what is fair. It's kind of like she is detached from the situation. She's backwards from it rather than kind of in the thick of it. But she sees it very, very clearly. I love her. I think she's amazing. Now, if there is one card in this deck that I know would be the one that I would want as my poster hanging up, probably on my bedroom wall, right? It has to be this one. Oh my God. Look at the Hanged Man. I mean, he is so cool. That is just my all-time favorite Hanged Man. I mean, there is nothing about him that, I don't know, he does not come across as sacrificial whatsoever. He is just kind of like in a position that is kind of like allowing him to just kind of like hang there perfectly happily and weigh up the situation. I just think he's gorgeous. The Hanged Man. Perfect. Now, death. It's serious. I mean, yeah, it is kind of like death has arrived. It's not a skeleton. I mean, he's got the skulls sort of hanging off of his pocket down there. But yeah, I mean, it's just, he's just doing a job. It's kind of like, well, you know, it's your turn now. He's arrived to do what he has to do. I mean, he looks kind of like serious. I don't know that he necessarily enjoys his job, but he's kind of getting on with it. He looks like a sort of night watchman to me. That is the death card in the Lunatic Tarot. Okay. So now we have Temperance. Look at her. Very, very kind of like, you know, again, he's really gone for the kind of the big full breasts. Yeah, she's got like the cups there. Yeah, she's got the angel wings. I don't know if I would get, I like the Temperance card in the Rider-Waite. I like the fact that it has that pathway and it kind of seems to be leading to something that's kind of like really positive. I'm not saying this card is negative. I don't know if I would get as much from this other than, yes, it's another sexy woman, as I do from the Rider-Waite. But again, she didn't come up in either of the readings that I did. So yeah, I mean, she's pretty hot. I mean, she's gorgeous. Okay. Oh, maybe after the Hanged Man, this might be my next favorite card for the poster. The devil. I mean, really, look at this devil. Female devil. Oh my gosh. Temptress. I mean, I just think she is fabulous. Absolutely fabulous. Yeah, she's naughty, this devil. Yeah, I mean, there is something about her that rather than be kind of obviously kind of monster-like and evil, it's kind of like, oh, come on, let's have some fun. Let's be naughty. I don't know whether she's more tempting, that more people would kind of give in to her. Food for thought there. An amazing, amazing image. Okay. Now you're going to have to really look hard on this. This is brilliant. I hope I can get it from the kind of perspective. This looks like, it's like, this is the tower. This looks like a sort of cathedral. I mean, it's from, obviously, yeah, it's from the ground up and the way it kind of like all blends into the night sky, being sort of struck by that lightning. I mean, that is such a marvelous painting. That is such a marvellous painting. It is very much like a sort of haunted house to me, or kind of, I would not want to spend the night in there alone, apart from the fact that it's being struck by lightning. And there's something about, he's got certain images, there's more kind of like coming up, that kind of lend itself to this style of his art. So even though he's got the colour scheme going on throughout the whole deck, some of them have this kind of elongated thing. He hasn't done it in all of the cards at all, but there's certain ones that have it. And I kind of feel if quite a few of those came up for me in a reading, where it's very much, instead of a bird's eye view, it's kind of like from the ground upwards, and things get smaller as they go up. That would say something to me if I did a reading and a lot of these type came up. Okay. The Star, very different. I mean, I suppose like the white and the negative photo-y sort of thing, it adds a sort of an innocence. I'm a little bit, I don't know if I like the fact that she's covering herself up, simply because one of the things I love about the Star card is how, in the usual Rider-Waite, is how comfortable she is in her own skin, and how she's kind of, you know, she doesn't feel she has to sort of cover anything up at all. She's just very, very natural. And I'm just very conscious of the fact that she's covering herself. And so therefore, this is giving a bit of a different message than I would get in my usual deck. But that's fine. That's fine. This would come up for a reason. Yeah, I do see it as a little bit like a negative photograph. Interesting. Now. Or a little bit of a twist. Well, it's a little bit of a twist, it is, but it isn't, because obviously there are certain cards in the traditional that are to do with children. The Sun, lovely imagery. The colours are vibrant. It's very kind, it is very summery and happy. And although it's a little girl, she's got kind of like boobs and they are covered up. So, I don't know, there's still something, it's something about this is kind of more like a young teenager, and it is a little bit kind of fairy tale-y. I don't know if it's creepy or not, I can't make my mind up, but he has got a few child images that come up throughout the deck, so I'd just be interested in other people's opinions. But if you just go with the sunflowers and the fact that it is definitely a young girl, I would definitely say, you know, she's got her little toy there with her. There is a brightness there in that image. Okay. Amazing. The Moon. Look at that. Look at that card. Again, we've got the young maiden. And he's gone with the Sun and the Moon. He's gone kind of like the clothes they're wearing are quite old fashioned. Whereas kind of a lot of the other images so far are all very sort of punky and funky and quite modern looking. This looks very sort of Victorian or something. Look at that Moon though. I mean, it's just incredible. And it's kind of like the innocence there. There's something about, you know, you wait until kind of like your life becomes more revealed as time goes by and things start to become more apparent. Like right now, you're just innocent and untouched and you don't need to worry about it. I find that Moon a little bit disturbing. I'm not going to lie, a little bit. I'm not quite sure how to take it. Again, it would depend on the reading. Do you get what I mean? Okay, so now we have Judgment. Eek. Yeah, this is quite a, I don't know, she looks really, really sad. And this is definitely kind of like a graveyard. It's kind of, I don't know. I mean, yes, she is blowing a trumpet, But I just feel there's something really kind of sad and solemn about this judgment card. It's, I don't know, it's maybe like finding out things you didn't want to find out, which I don't necessarily always get from the Rider-Waite. This has just got a bit of a different vibe to it altogether. Okay. And the World. Here she is. Little Bo Peep light. Again, very sexy, this really buxom woman. But I get it because in the world, even in the World card, we have a kind of like a naked woman all wrapped up. But yeah, she's definitely, she's very steampunky, I would say. And I kind of like feel she's of this world. It's of this earth. Yeah, I don't know. I just see cornfields and all that sort of thing. That's what I get from this World card. She's very wholesome, very wholesome. Okay, so whizzing through the wands now. Okay. Ace of Wands. No hands coming out of the sky. Just some guy with a big wand. Earthy looking guy with a big wand, sort of like arriving on the scene, ready to start something. That could be very Mars, actually. He could be there for trouble, possibly. Not necessarily. He's definitely kind of there to take some sort of action. Two of Wands. Okay. So again, sexy, cool looking character. Yeah. I mean, I like the big coat. I'm just trying to have a look at, wait a minute, hold on. Yeah, I mean, is he planning? Yeah, I would say he's contemplating. He's contemplating what's going to happen next. He's kind of looking in the other direction from those wands, so that might say something. The Three of Wands. So, yeah, just another very, very sort of like cool character. I don't... This is another one I'd like to ask him about, because I'm not sure what I am getting from that. I'm really not sure what he's trying to say. There's something about him kind of leaning backwards. Don't know. Some of these out of context, I just feel this burning desire to know why he made the choices he did on some of them. Now, I was talking about the ones that are kind of like from the ground up and the thing itself looks quite far away. I absolutely love this. Look at that Four of Wands. I think that is just a fabulous piece of art. It's kind of like you've got to get all the way up there. I don't know if that's high at the top of the hill or if that's just abstract and it's a path, although it doesn't get smaller. So perspective wise, it only looks in the distance because it's up. So I kind of see that as up, like the only way is up. And the two people are up there. Love it. I love it. And he's got some other cards in that style. The Five of Wands. So instead of having the five characters, there is just one character, but there is all that stuff going on in, you know, the background. It's kind of, it doesn't need all the other characters in it. I think that is going on in his mind. It's kind of like it feels as though there's a certain amount of conflict, things to sort out. It's got action in it. I kind of like feel the coat is moving. It's got movement in it, this card. He's very cool. I don't know if he's the same person from the Lovers card, maybe. Okay, Six of Wands. He looks happy. He looks really, really happy. And I just feel that, yeah, again, those kind of circular things are just people sort of like holding up their spears to sort of celebrate him. I feel the accomplishment there with this card. It doesn't need to actually show all the other people. You kind of know that they're there. He's got an awareness of his surroundings. I like him. Okay, the Seven of Wands. I keep wanting to say Rod Stewart. But anyway, there he is again with his amazing hairdo. Seven of Wands, it's kind of, yeah, he's got kind of like all those wands around him. Again, I just feel there's kind of like work to do. There's things to be done. Or whether he's done it already, I don't know. I definitely feel the action and the vibrancy in this suit of wands. And he's got that black and white coat. So there's that choice there again. So I kind of like feel, in a sense, he might have a lot to do, but the situation is, still has a certain sort of clarity about it. The Eight of Wands. Okay. I just love it. Let me try and get it into the light. It's so, so busy. There is just so much going on. I wish you could actually see the card kind of like live, because just the lighting on it is brilliant. It, to me, it just sparks life. I just think it's great. The difference between this and the kind of the traditional is, you know, that they're not all a whole load of ones all going in the same direction. This is very all over the place, but it is all happening. I think it's marvelous. Okay, the Nine of Wands. Hey, get this for a kind of security guard or however you see the Nine of Wands. He really is on the lookout. He is on the lookout. I just find him very, very sort of cool. Is he hurt? Well, he has got the thing round his head, so possibly. I possibly might get something from in a reading from the fact that he is wearing the sunglasses. Yeah. Yeah, he's a warrior, definitely. Ten of Wands. So okay, you may remember in the Rider-Waite, the guy is struggling to sort of walk with the wands all on his back. Well, this one's just basically collapsed. Exhaustion. That's what I'm getting here. Absolute exhaustion. But you might see something different here. I don't know. But to me, he definitely looks like he's just had enough. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so moving on to the Page of Wands. Okay, so we have another very young girl here. So she's very sweet, the Page of Wands. I get this. Yeah, I kind of think she's sweet. She's kind of, you know, she's enthusiastic. She's vibrant. She's alive. I think it's all the qualities of the Page of Wands. And yeah. I totally buy this card for the Page of Wands. I think she's lovely. She looks happy as well. Sunny. The Knight of Wands. Oh, okay. I mean, yeah, I mean, he's just a cool, sexy character. Yeah, he has got a horse there. Yeah. Wrapped around his leg by the look of things, is it? But yes, I mean, yeah, he's not on the horse. The Knight of Wands, I don't know. I just feel so there's something cowboyish about him, or like a kind of, or almost, I definitely sort of feel the motorbikey kind of thing, image with him. I don't know. He's a cool guy, the Knight of Wands. Now, the Queens and the Kings, all of them, I will kind of go through these quite quickly. They are all a little kind of group within themselves. They are beautifully dressed. I mean, I suppose, yes, we had the Hierophant and the High Priestess. They're very, very clothed, the kings and the queens, but their gowns are stunning. I mean, look at her. She is the Queen of Wands. I mean, look, it's the tapestry and the detail that is there in her costume. I mean, she is absolutely gorgeous. I mean, that's going to take some sort of like study on its own. But, you know, her male counterpart, her king, very serious looking King of Wands. But again, like the robe, I mean, it's just absolutely stunning. Very kind of regal. I mean, yeah, very, very regal. And you'll sort of see a similarity with all the other queens and kings. Ace of Pentacles. I mean, where's the pentacle? Where is it? I mean, maybe it's sort of on the cloak. I mean, he's well dressed. I'm kind of left wondering about this one. I really, really am. I would not look at that kind of thing. Oh, that has to be the Ace of Pentacles. But it is. But I can't really see it. It could be there in the pocket. That thing kind of there. It's not very obvious that that is the Ace of Pentacles. And I wonder why. So that would be relevant in the reading. Oh, this Two of Pentacles. My God, again, this has got to be one of my favourites. Look at her. It's just gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous. So again, you know, you've got that entertainer, juggler, acrobatic quality. You've got the waves there. Oh, I just think she is fantastic. And there is just something really creative and artistic, big, big time with this Two of Pentacles. This is definitely one of my favourite images in this deck. I love her. Absolutely love her. Three of Pentacles. Again, I suppose, yes, we have the teamwork thing here. There's no sign of any pentacles. But yeah, you kind of like possibly got your, if you've got a team, you need the kind of like the big boss. Maybe you need the kind of like the creative person. I see that as the guy at the front, and maybe the other sort of younger guy at the back is the kind of like the one that kind of like does all the kind of like the lifting and the hard work, whatever it is. I don't know. They're all different to each other, but they come together as a group and as a team. So I'll buy that as the Three of Pentacles, but no pentacles. I like the fact that Evan doesn't feel that he has to sort of spell every little thing out to you. The Four of Pentacles. Love her. Love her. I mean, you can't necessarily see that there are four pentacles there, maybe. But I just love the fact that she's clinging hold of them. She's hiding behind them. So that I do get something different from this than from the Rider-Waite. It's kind of, yeah, she's kind of hiding behind her riches and her money. I mean, maybe that's how I'd interpret it. But they are big. They are big. That says something as well. And they are very much hers. It's like, don't touch my pentacles. The Five of Pentacles, very different feel on this. They look fed up. They look bored. Do they look like they're victims? Do they look like they're feeling sorry for themselves? Maybe. It's more like boredom. It's a bit like, oh, what the hell? And it's almost like they don't really care. That's what comes across in this. And that. I don't think I've ever said that about the usual Five of Pentacles, but it's reasonable. And you have got the Five of Pentacles up there on the window. The Six. There he is. So yes, he's being very kind and generous to those two little girls that are sort of kneeling at his feet. Something a bit weird about that, I think. Something a little bit weird. It's kind of like, well, I'll look after you, but I kind of own you. That's my immediate reaction to that image, but that would not necessarily always be my reaction, because again, it always comes down to context within the reading. But it, yes, it's, in a weird kind of way, that could almost be like a devil card for me, in a kind of like a less sinister way. But then look at the devil card in this deck. I mean, she was very kind of like, let's go play. Now, here's another one of the elongated cards. Oh my God, I think, I really, really like these about this artist. So here we have the Seven of Pentacles. Look at it. I think that's amazing. I kind of adore it. So yeah, I mean, there he is, he's putting his hand up. He looks quite happy about his accomplishment. It's like, you know, he's put, I definitely feel he's put the work in, and now that tree has grown so high, he can't even reach it. I love him. I love it. That's one for the wall for me. Now here is a very unusual Eight of Pentacles. Brace yourself for this, because I had to look twice to realize what this was. The Eight of Pentacles. So it's a person sitting down and his foot is on one of the pentacles. Yeah, it's like he's on a tea break or something. It's, yeah, I mean, I suspect that in the context of a reading, that is going to say different things a lot. Well, like they all will. That is definitely a very, very different take on it to the traditional. I like it. I do like it. Okay. One of my favorite cards in the Rider-Waite, here she is, the Nine of Pentacles. And to me, she looks kind of like Spanish, or, you know, like she's doing the Tarantella. I mean, this is a celebration if ever there was one. She's lovely. The card's lovely. It's very, very vibrant. It's very celebratory. I think she's lovely. She is lovely. I think she's doing a dance. It's happy. That has got a very good feel. She has got the bird there on her arm. Yeah, amazing. Another one of those long, tall, thin ones. The Ten of Pentacles. Get this. Don't you just love it? Don't you just love it? So the granddad at the front looks a bit grumpy, but I'm loving the little family up at the back and the bridge, and oh, it's so cool. I really, really like it. I just wish he was smiling a little bit more, Mr. Granddad of the Ten of Pentacles. Okay, so now we have the Page of Pentacles. This is very strange. She's sitting down on top of a hill with her hand reaching forward, bent over. She's sort of like naked with some sort of floaty big gown. Page of Pentacles. Please explain this card. Somebody, what does it mean? I think you've just got to completely ignore any preconceived, you know, whatever pages might mean to you, because I always see them as being quite straightforward, uncomplicated, simple. There's something going on here that doesn't tie in with anything that I have page related for me. I think it's a very interesting image, and I just need further explanation, seriously, on this one. I like it. I like it as a piece of art. If anybody happens to have the book that goes with this Lunatic Tarot, please, I'm begging you, get in touch with me. Okay, the Knight of Pentacles. Okay, so he's got a kind of, he's, well, not kind of, he has a pentacle on his top. And he's walking. And he's cool. What else is he saying? Don't know. Don't know. But yes, he is the Knight of Pentacles. He's a young, handsome man. Maybe he's kind of, made a bit of money. He looks good. He's fit. Don't know. Don't know. And once again, I'm going to show these together, the Queen and the King of Pentacles. Again, luscious. They are holding their pentacles. The Queen's are very, very covered up in all of them. Now, there's no sort of, boobs hanging out with the Queen's. This King looks a bit younger than the last one, or he looked a bit stern, the last King. But again, they do have very elaborate clothes. Okay. The Ace of Swords. So, yes, okay, so it's a person with a sword. I think, is it a woman? Hang on. Not sure, not sure. So yeah, again, it's someone who has arrived on the scene with their sword. They're quite covered up. Their sword is down, so I don't think they mean trouble. Yeah, the background is quite kind of grayey, sort of airy, I suppose. Don't know what I kind of specifically get from that image on the Ace of Swords. Are they making an offering? I'm being very traditional here. No, it doesn't feel like it unless they come in peace. I mean, it could be that. Okay. Two of Swords. Very sexy image. The two swords are on her back. The moon is there, which I'm sort of pleased to see that. She is blindfolded, so it's kind of like she doesn't kind of like know what's in store, but it's she's not got those sort of two swords upright, showing the sort of, I don't, well, I suppose they are poking upright. Yeah, maybe the meditation thing is there, but is there a reason why her boobs are sort of like out in this card? And there's a kind of key. There is a key around her neck. That's probably, that would be symbolic as well. The Three of Swords. That's pretty brutal. That is pretty brutal. Yep. That speaks, it's painful. That card is painful. So, yeah. Okay, the Four of Swords. I mean, basically, I kind of like see that character as lying in a coffin. I do definitely see that character as more as dead. I mean, you could say the character in the Rider-Waite is dead, but it could also be peaceful, resting. This definitely looks dead to me. But at peace. Five of Swords. I like this one. I really like this one. I kind of like feel that the characters in the background, there's something about this that they all look like they're on the same team. Even though he's the one standing at the front that's got the swords in his hand and the other swords are on the floor, I just feel they're all somehow in the same sort of mood about the situation. I'm not getting the smug thing there with him. So it does look as though there has been some sort of defeat there that I think has affected them all in the same way. So whether they are the ones who've been defeated or whether they are the ones who have done the defeating, I'm not sure. So that may become apparent if it's upright, reverse, whatever the question is. The Six of Swords. Again, that's got a real solemnness about it, but it is the boat and the swords kind of moving away. The Seven of Swords. Oh, sneaky. So look, there's someone hiding and there's someone else kind of, well, whether they're looking out for them or they're about to discover them, I don't know. I like that. I really, really like that. My immediate thing is sneaky. Hiding. Eight of Swords. Whoa. She looks like she's in trouble there. That looks really difficult to get out of. That looks really, really difficult to get out of. And if she does manage to rip all those bonds and things off her, where's her clothes? You know, I suppose there's some sort of cloth there she could cover herself with. But I feel for her. I do feel for her in that. Okay, the Nine. Oh my God, she just looks so troubled. I mean, yeah, same kind of thing as in the normal deck. This is someone who's got anxiety. She's just got so much on her mind. Troubled, absolutely. Something very real and modern about that image. Ten of Swords. That is a kind of like, yeah. I mean, the character is half not even showing. Very, very stabbed in the back. Yeah, very kind of. That's been quite an ugly battle, I would say, with casualties in one way or another. The skies are very angry in that card. Page of Swords, another little girl. Sweet, nice, yeah. She and it kind of almost, yeah, it's a funny looking sort of sword, but yes, yeah, she's well, you know, she's there's something sporty. I don't, it's like she's going to play some sort of cricket or something. I don't know, but she's come to, yeah. There's an innocence about that. In a yeah, I don't find that particularly threatening. Okay, Knight of Swords. He's very cool. He's got his horse there. Okay, Knight of Swords. Again, is it apparent that he is the Knight of Swords? I don't know. Not especially. It hasn't got that speed thing going on that the Rider-Waite has got, but it's possibly got other qualities. And again, we've got the King and the Queen of Swords. Very elegant. Her headdress is a lot less elaborate than the Queen of Pentacles. They're quite streamlined, but again, beautiful, beautiful colours on those. Okay, so last but not least, we have the Cups. Look how sweet the Ace of Cups is. I mean, she's lovely. She's smiling. She's happy. The bird is there. She's a little girl. It's innocence. It's baby-like. Two of Cups is gorgeous. There's something much sweeter about this than the Lovers one, but it's similar in a way. I mean, it's just lovely. It really is like your first, you know, your first encounter with romance. They just look really, really young, but not too young, you know, grown up enough to just really love being with each other. I think it's lovely, the Two of Cups. The Three of Cups. Again, I love the fact that you can tell that there's a lot of people there, even though we only see one, because there's all of those cups happening. He's happy. It's kind of sociable. It's lovely. Happiness. Four of Cups. Wow. He's not going to take it. He is. But I don't see how he's not noticing it. Maybe he's thinking about taking it. There's just a little bit of a different feel than on the Rider-Waite. Although there's a similarity here, he's thinking about it in this one. The five. Oh my God. Look at that. Whoa. I think there's a lot of kind of thought can go into that strange building in the background. I mean, in the kind of traditional deck, you've got the bridge and you've got the river and you've got the house in the background. That is something about that house in the background that is telling stories. I'd really like to do a reading on this one to come up and see what my intuition said about that house in the background. Interesting. Interesting. Okay, the Six of Cups. So he's feeding this little child a drink. Yeah, he's holding up the cup and sharing. It's nice, it's sweet, it's quirky. But yeah, they are sharing. It's a sweet, very different sort of image for this Six of Cups. Now, are we ready for the Seven of Cups? Now, just remember, the Seven of Cups in the Rider-Waite is kind of fantasy, illusion, all that sort of thing. I mean, she's got the same hair colour as me, but apart from that, I think that's where the similarity ends. I mean, that is quite a painting. Yes, maybe that does represent certain people's fantasy and illusion. And maybe on the inside, if you got to know her, you would sort of see past all of that kind of stuff. I don't know. That is quite a Seven of Cups. And if you look at it, you don't even notice the cups because the image itself is so striking, but there are seven cups there. And so obviously she is the one making the choices, I think. Whoa. The Eight of Cups. Got the Moon there again, got the Eight Cups. He's kind of, yeah, it's coming at this from the other angle. He is walking away from those cups. So in a certain sense, there is a sort of similarity. Yeah, I just feel he's getting away from it. He's walking towards us rather than walking away from the cups with his back to us, which, so it's from a different perspective, but I kind of like feel there is a similar message. Possibly. This one's gorgeous, the Nine of Cups. Look at her. She's just fabulous. She is just fabulous. And those nine cups are there. There's that, it's just the way she's looking up at that space, like that one cup missing. Is she a bit of a perfectionist? I don't know. But I kind of think she looks pretty kind of all right, you know, satisfied, whatever. I love it. I love it. Another one of these long ones, the Ten of Cups. Look at it. It's so amazing. So you've got the arm at the bottom. Well, you've got two arms with the birds on them and the Ten Cups. And then you've got the kind of like the rainbow and the people at the top of the hill. Right, it's Mandy. I'm back again. My computer ran out of charge. So just to finish off what I was saying about the Ten of Cups. So yeah, I noticed that he's got like two doves or birds balanced as well on both of the hands, which is quite an interesting take on this Ten of Cups. So the Page of Cups. There he is. Here we again, we have another one that, is that a, hang on, that's a cup. at the top, I think. One second, let me just. Is it? Yeah, it looks like he's got a cup at the top that he's drinking from. But it's quite a strange page of cups, to be honest. I mean, the page of cups in the traditional Rider-Waite deck is so lovely. So I know it's like one of Sharon's favourite cards, and I think she'd be quite disappointed with this page of cups, if I'm really honest. I mean, he's sort of like dressed a little bit like a tiger. I don't particularly get it. As an initial thing, I don't get a lot out of this particular page of cups. It's not one of my favourites. The Knight of Cups. He's nice. He is handsome. Yeah, there is that sort of dreamy, sort of romantic-y feel. I mean, he's obviously relaxed. His horse is sort of peaceful in the background rather than kind of like attached to him or involved in some sort of action. It's like they're taking a break. Yeah, it's nice. It's a nice page of cups. And then we have the Queen and the King of Cups. Again, these highly, highly elaborate costumes that they're wearing. Yeah, I mean, they've definitely got the Queens and the Kings kind of like very much sort of paired up as partners throughout the whole deck. Yeah, they've got their cups there. Okay, so that's them. And they seem to, is it fish that they've got on them? At the bottom. Yeah, it's like, are they in standing in cups or boats? I think they're in boats or cups or in the sea, sort of like waves. There's a little bit more definition, I think, with these, like that they are the Queen and the King of Cups. Okay, so that's the usual 78. However, Evan has given us two additional cards in this deck. I don't know why he's given us two additional cards, and I don't know why he's given us these particular cards. So this is something I would really, really like to know. I'm absolutely serious. If anybody has got that book or has got the deck, you know, and they bought it and it's come with a book, please get in touch with me. So the two additional cards are as follows. There is this one. I don't know what to say. I really don't know what to say. I mean, she's like a young girl. She's got a bell around her neck, which suggests she might have some sort of disease. And she's just got this painful thing going on with her boobs. I don't understand. I don't understand this card and why it's been included. It's obviously saying something. And the other additional card is this one, which is sort of more again young girl, but she's got her foot amputated. She's kind of like a puppet. She's got no arm. I mean, it's really quite a disturbing image. They both are, and these are the kind of like the bonus cards that you get. By the way, the reverse of the decker is this image. I really do need to do some full readings with this deck, because I need to see how the deck kind of like works when you're looking at a whole load of the cards together. It might be sort of like quite interesting. Like I say, if you had all of those long thin ones coming up or all of the childlike ones coming up, I think they could make some really sort of like bold readings. Or if it's just all the kind of sexy guys, I mean, that's a kind of message in itself. I don't know. I think there's some of the artwork in this deck is, for me, so striking. I absolutely love it. So yeah, I just want to say it's a very, very interesting deck. I think when it's good, when it is good, and when that artwork is kind of like really, really saying something, I think they are really, really striking, bold images. I think they'll make some amazing readings. Some of it is a little bit odd, a little bit too abstract for me. But again, in context, I'd like to feel that I would take that statement back. So it would just be interesting to do some readings using it as a whole, putting it into context and seeing kind of like how it really, really works when you've got, I don't know, 10, 12 cards in the spread, how it all speaks to each other. But it's been really, really a nice opportunity to go through it. So I hope you enjoyed it, and bye for now.